Has artificial intelligence finally solved the problem of microphone feedback? Here, take a listen to what happens when a microphone gets turned up too much or just gets too close to a speaker. Let's reach down here and turn it on. Check 1, 2. I mean, it's the most basic fundamental difficulty with live sound systems, where it's possible for the sound from the speaker to get picked up again by the same microphone connected to it. And that sound gets looped back through the system again and again. Let's turn the mic off. Feedback has probably ruined several concerts or events you've been to, whether that's a conference or a church service or a wedding. The craziest thing is that despite all of the incredible technological advancements in the audio industry, this simple and unbelievably annoying phenomenon continues to happen regularly all around the world. There are, of course, classical methods and solutions that people try to use to avoid this problem, but they usually destroy the purity of the sound, and those that don't end up not working very well. What we need is a revolutionary new way for everyone to easily prevent this, no matter the quality of your equipment or your level of experience. Let's take a quick listen to what an AI-based solution can do. So we've turned on the microphone again, but now let's engage the AI processing on this microphone so you can hear how it prevents the feedback from happening without changing anything else about the vocal sound. And all I did was turn it on. It does all of the work for me instantly. There's also several other benefits to using an AI-based approach. For example, it can eliminate the room reverb and some amount of background noise too. Like right now, I'm standing in our company warehouse and you can probably hear the sound of that coming through this little microphone I'm wearing on my shirt. But later, while I'm editing this video, I'll apply the AI processing right now and we'll just leave it on. You can hear how dry it makes the microphone sound, almost like I stepped outside. This is also important for fighting feedback because a lot of times it's the room reverb itself that excites the microphones into feeding back through the speakers. If we can get rid of the reverb in a microphone that's going to a speaker, it sets up the preconditions necessary to have as little feedback as possible to begin with. And then, of course, any feedback that actually does want to start building up in the signal is also taken out by the AI. In larger, more reverberant rooms, stopping the room reverb from being re-amplified through all of the various speakers throughout the venue is effectively like acoustic treatment and can drastically increase the intelligibility of the vocal sound, even aside from fighting feedback specifically. And also for recording or live stream or broadcast purposes, you can really tighten up the sound of the vocal in the mix. Let's talk about how it works. In order to make an audio plugin that can do this, I started Alpha Labs, a software company in Oregon. And we built an AI training computer from scratch and developed our own proprietary AI model. We now sell a plugin called DFeedback that you can try for free at dfeedback.ai. Now, a lot of people might not understand how AI works, so here's the basics. If you think about detective work, and let's say two detectives are called to a crime scene to investigate what happened. The first detective is fresh out of school, full of book knowledge, knows the rules, and they see a broken window and some items are missing. And they figure it's a burglary. The other detective is a 40-year seasoned veteran, and they notice things and put small details together to form a more complete understanding of what's going on. So for example, they notice the glass from the broken window is mostly on the outside of the house, and the items that are missing are things which only someone living in the house would know about. And also the family dog doesn't seem too bothered by the whole ordeal. And they might conclude that this is a staged burglary. So in the world of AI training, we might say that the younger detective is kind of like basic machine learning. It can follow rules and come to conclusions over time based on those rules, but it never really understands the situation. And so there's often limits to the effectiveness of basic machine learning for certain complicated or nuanced things. The seasoned veteran detective is more like a neural net AI, which has a much more sophisticated way of approaching tasks and comes to approximate what, in the human sense, we might call something like understanding. If we take this a step further, we can build a deep neural net model, which has such an incredible level of complexity and sophistication that it starts to do things that we humans might call intuition. Even from the human standpoint, you don't always understand your own intuition. Things just strike you as obvious, and you come to trust the results of acting on your intuition over time. With basic machine learning, we could probably get to the point where an AI could do something like eliminate echoes in a vocal signal. Pretty simple. But if we want to eliminate something like room reverb, we need a neural net to handle this because that's so much more complicated to do. And we'd probably have to help it out a little bit by having a kind of learning period where we have it briefly listen to just the sound of the reverb or the specific person talking into the mic. And then it can come to understand the general difference between the vocal and the reverb sound and separate the two and eliminate one of them going forward or whatever we want it to do. But if we want the AI to be able to isolate the voice from the reverb, no matter who is talking and in any room without any direction or help, we need a deep neural net which intuits the difference between these things, just like a real human brain. Now, how do we do this? Well, first, we collect a lot of training data, terabytes and terabytes of data. We end up with basically two categories of audio data for the AI model to think about. Dry vocal data, which we'll call the target data, and room IR, or impulse response data. I actually took the time to travel around to many different venues in my area and take audio impulse responses for this project. An impulse response is basically like an audio snapshot of how the room sounds. So if you took any other sound, like a dry vocal recording, and stamped every little bit of that recording with the impulse response as the vocalist was singing or speaking, it would come out the other side sounding like they were in that room. This process is called convolution, and I actually made another more in-depth video about this that you can check out in the description below. The AI model takes each bit of target data and convolves it with each IR in this gigantic matrix. Then it uses the target data to null or cancel out the portion of the newly convolved data that contains the target data, leaving behind what we'll call residue. In our particular case, the IR data is that of rooms, so the residue is just the leftover roomy sound without the vocal sound. Then we split up the residue into tiny frequency sections called bins. Then perform an FFT analysis on each bin and track the changes in frequency distribution and amplitude and phase over time. And we compare all the bins with each other. The basic task of the AI model is to come up with some math equation, literally any mathematical expression that it can possibly think of, to quantify what about the collective spectrographical nature of the residue from all the bins is unique to the residue and not representative of any part of the target data. When the model has done its best to come up with such a math equation, however absurdly abstract or large, this is what we might call an act of intuition. That math equation can be used to intuit the existence of room reverb in a vocal signal from tiny counterintuitive cues in the audio data, things only our seasoned veteran detective would pick up on. We turn it into an audio filter, a plugin, that can be used by itself. That audio filter, by its nature, will take the incoming audio from a live microphone that has some part dry vocal and some part room reverb, and it will essentially use a spectrographical analysis combined with the giant math equation to identify the portions of the signal that are likely to be room residue. At this point, it will recreate an estimation of the IR that would be that of the room in the audio at that time. However, here's the secret. The IR then gets tweaked so that instead of being a mere estimation of the room IR in the simple sense, it's actually an estimation of the IR that, if you convolve the incoming audio through it, it would naturally reverse or cancel out the residue entirely. When this filter is applied in real time, as it constantly updates itself based on new spectrographical data, it nulls the residue portion of the audio signal, leaving only the dry vocal behind. Much easier said than done.
By her demeanor, the term wasting time did not appear to be in her lexicon. By her demeanor, the term wasting time did not appear to be in her lexicon.
By her demeanor, the term wasting time did not appear to be in her lexicon.
She didn't have any news beyond those 11 words, but it was something and represented some advantage over these people. She didn't have any news beyond those 11 words, but it was something and represented some advantage over these people.
But how do we also get rid of feedback? Well, our team realized that we could hijack the normal process for training a dereverberation algorithm and tweak the IR data to simulate the IR of feedback itself. We developed a proprietary feedback simulation engine, which sits there and pumps out tons and tons of feedback impulse responses that we throw into the data pool. We basically tricked a dereverb algorithm into also eliminating feedback. But of course, with a long list of highly specialized configurations and techniques to get it to actually work. For a long time there, it was looking like it wasn't going to work. We tried basically everything, but we had our big breakthrough and here we are. But see, if you want to use it for live sound, it has to be fast. It can't have a bunch of latency. But the problem is that these complex algorithms usually need latency because they have to have time to recognize the residue and then do the number crunching necessary to get rid of it. The lower the latency, the worse the performance, as a rule of thumb. The real magic behind what our team did is that we figured out how to do all of this and do it at zero added latency. It works right now, all the time. And it sounds really good. We didn't have to sacrifice quality or performance. I'm not even going to try to explain how we did this part. It's just too complicated. It's basically a bunch of coding magic that probably a small handful of humans on the planet actually understand, and I'm not one of them. Now, just so that there's no confusion, when I say zero added latency, it's because there's always some latency involved. I mean, the CPU has to run the program, and this might be a few microseconds, but many AI programs that are anything like this take 40 or more milliseconds on top of the inherent CPU speed in order to think about things and decide what to do so it doesn't make mistakes and sound terrible. That's unusable for live sound. And currently, as of the making of this video, none of the other ones even fight feedback specifically. So the DeFeedback AI plugin is one of a kind. If you want to use DeFeedback, the easiest thing to do is to go to defeedback.ai and download the trial version of the plugin and see how it works. The real challenge, of course, is finding hardware that can actually run the program reliably at low latency. It's probably one of the most CPU-intensive plugins on the market today. Now, I've seen people build these huge custom computers to run it, and there's also some expensive off-the-shelf options out there, but to get this in the hands of pretty much anybody that wants to start using it right away, we have some affordable hardware options on the website that we've calibrated very specifically for running DeFeedback with less than 5 milliseconds of total latency, which is perfectly fine for almost every live sound environment. That's the amount of time it takes for the audio input and output conversion, and then of course there's some dedicated to the inherent CPU buffering, but the plugin itself doesn't add any extra, so that's nice. You can get the latency down as low as the hardware itself will allow, and it's pretty cool to see what people come up with. Already, DeFeedback is being used and trusted by some of the biggest names and venues in the industry, as well as small companies and tiny venues all around the world. It works indoors, outdoors. You can read the FAQ on the website. It has a lot of great information about how to use it. Be sure to follow us here and on social media to stay up to date. Thanks for watching.